Andrew, I thought Canada was a good neighbor to the U.S., a close ally, but now we're making headlines with the caption, trade war. Yeah. What went wrong?
Well, we're not necessarily always the good guy in these things. So we have to start by looking at this, that countries always have interests and they always have special interests. And sometimes the special interests take precedence over the actual interests. So in the case certainly of dairy, there's no doubt that we've been operating a protectionist price-fixing cartel domestically that, among other evils, shuts out American milk, but more importantly, drives up prices to Canadian consumers. So what went wrong was somebody decided to make a stink about it. On softwood, it's not so clear. Historically, I think it is true to say that the provinces ran these things in a way that they charged a less than economic price for the stumpage piece. I don't think that's so clear anymore. So I think that's just, you can chalk that one up to the Americans are never going to be satisfied on that no matter what we do, I think.
We're on round five of that conversation.
Exactly. So there's fault on both sides, I guess, is the short answer to that. But you've also got a president who takes a very protectionist view of trade generally, sees trade in terms of winners and losers, us versus them rather than mutual benefit, is spoiling for a fight generally, not only with Canada, but with lots of other countries, has decided perhaps to make us an example, and has decided, I guess, to kind of, as a kind of a shock and awe, softening up of us prior to what we're anticipating to be pretty extensive negotiations on NAFTA or renegotiations of NAFTA. There's this barrage on the milk and softwood fronts to kind of, as I say, soften us up perhaps.
Wilbur Ross accused us of being protectionist. But now I want to ask you, Trump is approaching 100 days of presidency. He's always been, as you pointed out, and we know because we've heard this rhetoric from him, he's always been strong on American trade policy. So is this a tactic, another tactic by him? Is this another, or is this a diversion by him? What is this?
I think it reflects in some cases his honest beliefs, at least as he sees them at the moment. One of the difficulties in dealing with this presidency is he himself is so mercurial, to put a nice word on it. He changes his mind from day to day, depending on who talked to him last or what he saw on Fox News, or depending on which of the different factions within the White House is in the ascendancy. So it must be bedeviling people in our side of things trying to anticipate what they're going to do next, because from one to the next, as you've seen over the last few weeks and months, we've heard very different accounts from the United States about what was involved with this. Was it just going to be tweaking, quote unquote, or was it going to be a fundamental overhaul of NAFTA? So that's bedeviling. There's an additional element of uncertainty in that what the president can do and what the Congress will allow are not necessarily one of the same thing. The legal question about whether the president, for example, can unilaterally withdraw from NAFTA seems to be suggest that he probably can, but that it might be subjected to constitutional or legal challenge in the United States. So even that's not necessarily certain. So I think he is at bottom a protectionist in his mindset. As I say, I think as a subset of his generalized worldview of winners and losers and, you know, alpha males must predominate, et cetera, et cetera. I think it really is as crude as that. Plus, he's got around him in some cases, people who take a very mercantilist view of trade, that the business of trade is to rack up trade surpluses, as if it was sort of a profit and loss statement for a company. And any economist can tell you that that's just nonsense. The trade balance doesn't tell you anything about how your economy is doing or the benefits of trade, but they sincerely believe it.
In terms of trade and with respect to NAFTA, is it fair to say that everything that's traded should go into NAFTA, because lumber and dairy are not a part of NAFTA? So we export oil, electricity, and if you want to throw in even whiskey and maple syrup, should that all go into NAFTA?
Well, there's something to be said for that. That's right. I mean, we carved out some exceptions from the original free trade agreement between Canada and the United States, and then from NAFTA when we brought in Mexico, on both sides of the border for particularly quote-unquote sensitive sectors, i.e. powerful special interests. Culture is another one, for example, where we put all sorts of caveats and conditions and carve-outs and exceptions. And that may be what comes of these talks. And there's two ways in which these talks could go down. One is that we start unraveling NAFTA and start adding in all kinds of protectionist things. And there's no doubt that there's some in the Trump administration who would like to do that. Peter Navarro, for example, his trade advisor, has talked of including a rider in, not just in this one, but in generalized in U.S. trade agreements, that the minute the United States starts running a trade deficit with the partner in question, they trigger a renegotiation of the agreement, which is nonsense. So that's one route they can go, where we start slapping tariffs on each other, and that would be, I think, disastrous. The more beneficial route is you take the opportunity in this dilemma to actually push NAFTA in a more open trading direction. So, for example, if there was a trade-off that was arranged where we agreed to dismantle supply management and all of its protectionist paraphernalia in return for them agreeing to stop harassing us on softwood, well, that'd be a win-win for consumers and for trade and for trade liberalization. So that's going to be, I imagine, determined in the negotiations, and it'll depend upon what people's intentions are going into them.
And we'll see when those negotiations are going to be held. Apparently talks are being held this summer for NAFTA. Last question to you really quickly. I wanted to get your take on this. Another issue that Canada has to contend with now are the deep corporate tax cuts south of the border. How do we look? How does that affect Canada?
It's what I would call a good challenge. The United States has historically had...
That's very diplomatic.
Well, I think there's some possible good outcomes from it. The United States has historically had amongst the highest, if not the highest, corporate tax rates in the developed world, contrary to their buccaneering capitalist reputation. And they've been able to get away with it because they're in the United States, and the idea was, well, people will always want to invest in the United States. But there's limits to that. I think they've been pushing a long time, economists have, that for the United States to reform its tax code to get rid of a lot of the exemptions and deductions and credits that go to particular special industries and have a more neutral system with much lower rates. As they did, for example, in the 1986 reforms. If they're able to pull that off, that would be good for the United States, and it would also be good for us in the sense that it would force us to get serious about doing something similar here. We had quite uncompetitive corporate tax rates for many years, but in recent years, we had got it down to a level where we're quite competitive with the United States and with other countries. This would, if they get the kinds of cuts that they've been talking about, maybe 15 or 20% corporate tax rate down from 35%, that would pose a real challenge to us, and we'd have to get serious about cleaning up our own tax code. But in the end, we'd emerge with a system that was better for everybody. So it's going to certainly cause some recalculations on our side of the border if they're able to do it. Now, the big caveat on that is, the types of tax cuts that Trump is talking about are so large that they risk, if they're not offset with some other revenue source or some other spending cuts, they risk adding to the deficit of the United States. And the sort of arcana of U.S. law is, if you're doing anything that's going to add permanently to the deficit, I think you have to get 60 votes in the Senate rather than 50. So this may just be an opening bid in a long negotiation in the United States. So we'll have to sort of stay tuned and see what the final package looks like.
Okay, will do. Thank you for your time. I'm going to leave it at that. Thank you.